ASIS International and the International Foundation for Protection Officers presents Accelerate Your Security Career with ASIS and IFPO. Hello, and thank you for joining. I'm Janine O'Neill-Schmidt, Certification Specialist at ASIS, and I will be today's moderator. We have a great program ahead, but first, a few reminders. If you have a question during the presentation, type it in the chat, and we'll address it during Q&A at the end as time permits. Today's presentation is being recorded and attendees will be messaged when available. All microphones will be muted. Thank you again for joining today's webinar. I'd now like to introduce today's speakers. Erica Brown is the Director of Certification at ASIS International. She has nearly 20 years of leadership experience in the credentialing industry. At ASIS, she leads a team of certification professionals in the management, development, and global administration of four ISO IEC 17024 certification programs. In past roles, Erica has managed a team of program managers for an assessment consulting company and oversaw a large-scale licensure program. Erica currently serves as chair of the ICE Exchange Program Committee for the Institute of Credentialing Excellence. Erica also serves as the public member on the National Board of Examiners and Optometry Board of Directors. Gary Bergen is a distinguished security professional with over two decades of experience in strategic security management, operations, and training within high-risk environments. He is renowned for his proficiency in leading extensive teams, managing multi-million euro budgets, and overseeing security operations for prominent blue chip clients and high net worth individuals. His expertise extends to implementing sophisticated security protocols, conducting comprehensive risk assessments, and ensuring stringent compliance with industry standards. In recognition of his contributions to the field, Gary has been named an adjunct senior fellow at the Azure Forum for Contemporary Security Strategy, a fellow of the Institute of Strategic Risk Management, Security Institute of Ireland in 2023, and serves as the chair of the Institute of Strategic Risk Management's Irish chapter since 2002. He also holds positions on several prestigious boards, including the International Foundation of Protection Officers Security Advisory Board since 2022. He is a member of the ASIS Physical Security Steering Committee and has been appointed as a special advisor to the Board of Executive Protection Professionals in the US. Gary continues to influence global security practices through his role as an international council member of the United Associations Initiative, addressing current security concerns and enhancing the profession at an international level. His leadership and innovative approaches to security and risk management have established him as a leading figure and a respected voice in the global security community. Nadeem Iqbal has more than 25 years of security management and enterprise leadership experience spanning across the Middle East. After early years in the Pakistan Army, he moved to the private security arena and has led multi-million dollar business entities and projects. A specialist in security programs, strategy, and performance management, he holds an MBA, risk resilience major, and industry recognized credentials such as Certification Protection Professional, Certified Protection Officer Instructor, Certified in Security Supervision and Management, Project Management Professional, Balanced Scorecard Professional, Certified KPI Professional, Lead Implementer and Auditor for four management systems. He also has also successfully leveraged these learnings for business incubation and transformation projects. Nadeem is an IFPO volunteer leader, creating and sharing opportunities of self-development for aspiring security professionals in the Middle East, North Africa, and South Asia with Manasa. Nadeem has been a member of ASIS since 2005. He is also a fellow at Security Institute UK, the Institute of Strategic Risk Management, and an associate member at the Business Continuity Institute, and actively contributes at various professional forums. Matthew Purcelli is a safety security management specialist with over two decades of experience in the criminal justice and private security sector, working with clients and international airlines to corporate global headquarters and alongside municipal, state, and federal law enforcement partners. Matthew is a globally recognized volunteer thought leader, author, presenter, and featured in many global security periodicals. Matthew is a two-time former chair of the ASIS NextGen community and has made it his mission to mentor and guide young and transitioning security professionals throughout their career, especially those in contract security. Matthew has been a member of ASIS International for 13 years and serves as a community vice president, where he supports and works with steering community leadership and ASIS liaison staff for EPIC, executive protection, and operational intelligence communities, as well as designated a member and certified protection officer instructor with the International Foundation for Protection Officers. Hello to our panel. Thank you for joining us today. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Janine. Thank you, everybody, for joining today. We're excited to have you, and we have a fantastic panel to share a lot of great information today. For our agenda, we will be talking about the importance of professional development within the security environment, and then also how professional development can help your career advance. And then also we're going to talk about the career paths in security utilizing certification from both IFPO and ASIS. And then towards the end, we're going to help you get a little jump start when you're ready to get going. And then we'll allow some time for Q&A at the end. So please submit your questions, as Janine said, through the Q&A function in Zoom, and we'll answer those at the end. All right. To start us off, we'd like to have a little panel discussion. And the question I'd like to pose to our esteemed panel is, why is professional development important in the security profession? And Gary, would you like to kick us off?
Yeah, no problem. So I believe that professional development is crucial in security, and it's primarily due to the rapidly evolving technology and threat landscape that we work within. It also ensures that security professionals can maintain up-to-date skills, comply with industry standards, and can adapt to new risks, threats, and challenges. By fostering kind of specialized applications and culture, and have a culture of continuous learning, continuous professional development not only enhances individuals' career prospects, but also drives both organizational and industry-wide innovation. So ultimately, it equips security professionals to provide more effective and proactive security solutions while ensuring resilience in the face of emerging threats and risks.
Fantastic. Thanks, Gary. Nadeem, would you like to add?
Thanks, Erica. Yeah, certainly. We all undertake personal improvements and maintenance of our health and well-being. Likewise, there's a need to remain future fit and relevant on the professional front as well. This need certainly gets more strong as we move up the career, because we got to remain market competitive and employable, and every employer looks for diversity of skills in the people that they get. Nonetheless, as Gary said, the change is impacting the industry, every industry and the profession, so to say, and ours is not different by any means. The advancements in the technology, more importantly, the business practices and the global trends, not only impact the organizations, but also the production officers and their management who are involved in day-to-day operations. Hence, the need that we keep ourselves moving forward, upskilling and new skills. Thank you.
That's fantastic. Thank you. Matthew, what else would you like to add?
Well, thank you, Erica. So if anyone, no matter where they are on the globe, wants to advance in any profession, especially in this wonderful and diverse field of security, one must invest in oneself and stay current with the emerging threats and countermeasures in the protection of persons and fixed assets, and you know, such as property and brand and so forth. We have to remember that aggressors, criminals, delinquents, whether it be against the physical or the cyber, let's just say, you know, are getting smarter and better equipped each and every day. I mean, it's imperative for us as security professionals, regardless of what level of the hierarchy that you know, he, she, or they sit to train their mind and actions to exercise proactivity over reactivity. That's very important. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you all for that. So thinking beyond the global thought of professional development, I want to bring it down to the individual in each of your stories. So my question, next question to each of you is, how did you use professional development and certifications to advance your career? We heard a lot of credentials as Janine read through your bios. So obviously there are a lot of options out there. So as part of your response, please let us know, why did you choose IFPO and ASIS to be a part of your certification journey? Nadeem, let's start with you.
Thanks, Erica. As simply as I can put it, the priorities for development in terms of the knowledge areas and the skill set, they change with the time and the years that we have put in into the career. And the higher we go, the more complex the job becomes and greater is the need for the diversity of skills. For myself, in the early years, when I was involved in service delivery organizations, my focus was on learning the drills and tactics, helping my clients to get the best possible service. But as we move forward, I did realize that that's not all I need to have, and I need to sort of move forward to more understanding of strategic frameworks, understanding customer requirements, the impact of standards, the global regulatory aspects, etc., and the wider enterprise. I was lucky to start very early from the level 3 certification from the Security Institute. And then at a later stage, when I was managing a business branch, I did a program from IFPO, which was Certified Protection Officer. And moving on from there to a director's level, I pursued my CPP. And since then, it has been a journey where I keep adding something more. Now, you asked an interesting question, why IFPO and ASIS? I'm very confident that no other organization at the moment has a program so broad and comprehensive for the frontline officers as do the IFPO's Certified Protection Officer. And likewise, once you go to the more strategic roles, the CPP is by far the best and the most desired program. And I did the same after having done my research on the options and choices, the time that I could afford to spend on. I hope that says it all.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much. Matthew, can you tell us about your journey?
Oh, yes, Erica. Thank you. Yeah, so to me, security is a calling. It's not just a career. And if I was going to remain successful in this, you know, in this life's calling for me, is I had to envelop myself in the understanding of the security sector from the entry level and move upwards. That's how I started as a security officer for a contract security firm back in 2009. And as a contract security professional and now a manager after 20 years, I knew that remaining sedentary and inactive was not an option. And no one was going to make me reach my goals. I had to do it on my own. And again, I use that term broadly because thanks to ASIS and IFPO, I had some great, and I still have some really great mentors and people helping me guide me through this process. But it was finding a balance of humility and service while concurrently advancing through both personal and financial sacrifice to earn, you know, for example, my current CPP, my CPOI, my credentialing, and my certification designations. That was all done out of pocket. You know, and again, that I know it doesn't come cheap, but it's the light at the end of the tunnel. That's what I wanted to invest in because, you know, board certification, you know, especially me in a contract security management role, they're not that common. And I think that's the wonderful thing about, you know, however, in my own personal journey is that professional development and certifications, they work to advance your career if you're strong enough to point, you know, to be and patient enough. Let's not forget that word because patience is a virtue to pursue them. Now, as you know, Nadeem had just mentioned that, you know, ASIS and IFPO are amazing because they had made me you know, the professional, the security professional that I am today, and they're still making and helping me develop through my certifications and networking, the security manager that I am today. And quite frankly, you know, frontline security management, you know, again, like I said, it's not that common to see frontline security officers pursue certifications. However, IFPO, and you'll hear us talk about that later on, as well as ASIS with the APP and, you know, moving up to the CPP, there are some amazing, you know, obviously some amazing benefits that come from that. So hopefully in a roundabout way, that was my journey and it's far from over. Believe me, Erica. Thank you.
I love it. I love it. Continuous professional growth is definitely key here. Gary, let us know how your path has been.
Yeah, well, look, professional development and certifications have been instrumental in my career. They enabled me to remain at the forefront of security practices and technologies. So earning credentials like the CPP or the Chartered Security Professional demonstrated my commitment and my competence in the security field and deepened my expertise in risk assessments, crisis and emergency management, and that kind of stuff. So kind of this competence facilitated me within my various roles in leading these complex security operations and formulating strategic decisions for multinational corporations. So these qualifications enhanced my competency, confidence, and most of all, credibility with my clients, allowing me to contribute significantly to the development of industry standards and participate in some, you know, influential security councils and think tanks. You also asked, why did I choose IFPO and ASIS for my security certification? And it's kind of two answers to that. So both of these organizations offer distinct benefits, right, tailored to different stages and aspects of people in their security career. So if I start with IFPO, their focus is incredibly practical. So for example, their CPO program is designed not just to certify, but to genuinely prepare security personnel for a range of challenges that they're going to face on the front line. The curriculum covers crucial topics like access control, emergency management, and even ethics, which makes it ideal for anyone entering the field or looking to solidify their foundational knowledge. Then you have ASIS, which is world-renowned, you know, particularly the CPP certification. Like, that's really the gold standard for anyone aiming for senior management roles. So that's a comprehensive certification that's recognized globally and often required by some of the top employers in the industry. So ASIS doesn't stop at broad certification. They also offer specializations like the PSP and the PCI. So that means you can tailor your learning and certification to exactly what's relevant in your career ambitions. And additionally, ASIS is a gateway to an extensive network of people, providing access to the latest security research, some best practices, and the best development opportunities within the industry. So I believe that both IFPO and ASIS accreditations are about enhancing skills, boosting professional credibility, but also open doors to global career opportunities. And choosing them has been a strategic move in my career, preparing me for both hands-on security tasks and strategic leadership roles.
Thank you, Gary. I think all of your stories are so unique and individual. I hope that they do resonate with some of the folks listening in today. I think hearing your paths and growth from that initial security officer position up to all of you as leaders and managing incredibly complex projects and clients and being more strategic, like showing how your continued education has allowed you to really grow in your career, hopefully is really inspirational to our audience today. So thank you all. Okay, so we've been hearing a lot about a couple of these acronyms like CPO and the CPP. So what we'd like to do next is really dig in on the different certifications that both IFPO and ASIS offer. Each organization has multiple certifications that you can use to help grow your career, being that each career path is very unique to your interests and the opportunities that have been presented to you or that you seek out. We're going to keep this, you know, pretty broad because your journey is going to be different than Matthew's and it's going to be different than Nadeem's. But hopefully what you hear today gives you the inspiration to really get moving and push your careers forward. what we both organizations do follow with a lot of help to transition from other careers. Hopefully you're here because you are have been in the security management for a while or in security, or you might be new and you really want to understand how do I get a good foothold in this. So the next couple of slides should be really informative for you. As we review the following options, do keep in mind that there are different goals and requirements for each organization's certification programs. For IFPO, the certification program really emphasizes learning and knowledge transfer from entry level to mid-career. The IFPO certification prep courses help candidates prepare for each exam by identifying the areas of strength and weakness that you would need to study further to be successful. For ASIS, the exams test your competencies, and the eligibility criteria for each certification have been designed to evaluate if you have the requisite experience required that you'll then demonstrate competence on to be the competence required to be successful in that specific exam domains. And also for both, once you're certified, you are required to stay up to date in the domains covered by your certification. For ASIS, that means that every 3 years, over the course of 3 years, you'll be required to submit 60 hours of continuing education to support your recertification. Again, it's that continued professional development is really encouraged across the profession here. All right, Matthew, can you share a little bit about the IFPO program, please?
Sure, absolutely, Erica. Yeah, and this really, I know, resonates with me because, you know, once a security officer, always a security officer, as I, you know, I'm still in contract management, you know, so that's why I love IFPO, because again, it gives that push to those frontline personnel and offers the programs that you see there for that certification. So I'm going to go through them briefly. So we first start with the initial security officer program, the ISOP. This is more for individuals beginning or transitioning into the security sector. This certification will provide the foundation needed for those understanding the basics of asset protection for clients and the importance of life safety and communication. So think of this as the foundation if you're just coming into the security field as an entry-level security officer. Next, we have the Professional Security Officer Program, which is the PSOP. This applies to an individual who will be challenged more to delve deeper into critical thinking and make judgment calls, which may include, but this, you know, obviously this may not be limited to, this is actually definitely not limited to, noticing, let's say, imminent danger, such as civil unrest, for example. Security officers will learn self-reliance, which is very important because officers need to be able to think on their own, and also be not limited to the importance of a particular client's need, because clients are just as different and diverse as the officers that are employed. You know, every client is different. And as well as the difference between the duties of a security officer, excuse me, I should say the difference between what a private security officer is and what a police officer is. Because remember, depending on where you are in the world, there are certain restrictions and laws governing both security officers and police officers. Next, we have the Certified Protection Officer Program, which is the CPO. This here is the bedrock for security officers that are looking to further their career in security. This is the aha moment that I want to take my career as a frontline security officer to the next level to become a frontline security professional. This CPO certification offers a comprehensive number of domains that a frontline security officer, whether it be contract or proprietary, meaning either in-house, to safeguard against, let's say, a number of threats. And this can include, but not limited, because there's a lot within the program package, crisis intervention and risk management, executive protection and anti-terrorism, legal aspects of security, use of force, physical security, such as alarm systems, and workplace violence. Now we move on to, again, we're moving up in these certifications. Next, that individual has decided, you know what, I've done the CPO, I want to become a supervisor or manager. I want to lead a team of frontline security professionals. I want to grow. I want to keep going. That brings us to the Certified in Security Supervision and Management, hence CSSM. This certification is tailored for security professionals who want to, as I said, move up to site supervision or manager. And this is including and not limited to security director, a security ops manager. Remember, security ops managers can oversee various portfolios from, say, 3 clients to, in my own case, 57 clients that I've done at one point. Now, after that, you have the option to go for the Certified Protection Officer Instructor, which Nadeem, Gary, and I both hold currently, which is a CPOI. So those that earn the CSSM certification are usually tasked at a training function. So for example, I have security post orders at my locations and my sites that I train my officers on annually, quarterly, et cetera, both for compliance of my company and also for the client. And I have to make sure my officers are, their acumen is kept up to date on security, customer service, and fire and life safety. So the CPO designation gives that holder of that designation the opportunity to teach what they've learned from this previous CPO program or a portion therein. So the CPOI, must be, for you to have that certification to apply for it, you must be a current member of IFPO, completed the CPO program, and have at least 1 year of full-time or 2 years part-time security experience. And I just wanted to finish, Erica, to say with all these certifications, two things I just want our audience to remember. Number one, patience is extremely important. And number two, if you have the drive for it, you could accomplish any of this stuff. It's not going to happen overnight. Just make sure to know that if your heart's in it, you're going to achieve this. And, you know, and quite frankly, I've never looked back because these certifications, there's proof. And you could see from all those on this call and all those who have attended any of these courses, you know, IFPO and ASIS, we're the industry leaders for a reason. So with that, thank you very much, Erica.
Fantastic. Thank you, Matthew. That was a lot of great information. Okay, so next up are the ASIS certifications. We've heard a lot of discussion already about a little bit about APP and a lot about the CPP. We have actually a total of 4 certifications that ASIS offers. Starting at that more entry level or transitioning into the profession level is the, in the bottom right here, the Associate Protection Professional. And this certification is, you know, as you're getting started, and the APP is intended to measure your knowledge of security management fundamentals, business operations, risk management, and response management. And it really is to get you started. For the Associate Protection Professional, you are required to have at least 1 year of compensated security experience, or you can have 6 months of experience, plus if you have an approved credential for another association, maybe, say, one of the IFPO credentials, you can actually reduce that down to 6 months of work experience. Moving up from there, we have our kind of the next level based on years of experience. We have the PSP and the PCI. So the physical security professional and the professional certified investigator, both require 3 to 5 years of experience based on your education. And then for the physical security professional, we're going to be looking at your knowledge of the physical security assessment process, application, design, and integration of physical security systems, and implementation of physical security measures. Very, very focused on a very tight domain selection. Similarly, again, very focused, the PCI will measure your knowledge of professional responsibility and investigative techniques and procedures and case presentation. Again, 3 to 5 years of experience. That 3 year for both of them is if, say, you have a master's degree, and up to that 5 year is more if you have just a high school or, you know, just out of very initial level of education. And finally, as we said, the gold standard, the Certified Protection Professional, the CPP, is ASIS's highest level certification. It is very broad and encompassing. And in that certification, we measure your knowledge of security principles and practices, business principles and practices, investigations, personnel security, physical security, information security, and crisis management. This really is a very strategic and high level management level certification that's very encompassing of everything you've learned up to that point, essentially. Again, this one now requires 5 to 7 years of experience. So again, lots of work experience to supplement your studies as you prepare for this, covering those 7 domains that I just mentioned. All of the ASIS certifications are offered in English and Spanish at test centers, or you can test remotely through your at a computer in your home or at your office. And those are offered year round. And as I mentioned on a little bit ago, ASIS certifications require recertification every 3 years. And to do that, you would need to acquire 60 continuing professional education hours over that period. And then I want to highlight, because of where we're assuming that folks who are on this call are starting into the security profession or wanting to progress throughout your career, and maybe you're considering moving from the IFPO certifications over to the ASIS certifications. And we wanted to let you know that recently the Professional Certification Board, which is the ASIS certification governing body, has adjusted the eligibility requirements for the APP. Prior to the last 6 months, you would have needed 3 to 5 years of experience for the APP. Right around there. And I'm mistaking my information right now because it's old. But we wanted to make it more accessible to early career security professionals or early to in your transition. Now there's no specific education requirement. And as I said, that work experience was reduced to make it much more accessible for folks who want to pursue career growth throughout the certification programs. So we're going to talk a little bit more about that transition from IFPO over to the ASIS certifications, but we're really excited to have made that adjustment so that as you move through your career, that jump from IFPO to ASIS is a little bit easier for you. Okay. Part of that adjustment, when we looked at the adjustments for the APP eligibility, we went a little deeper and started working with IFPO last year to review the content domains included on both the IFPO CSSM certification and the ASIS APP certification. In doing so, we found that a significant amount of content overlap was there. So as we uncovered that, both organizations recognized the benefits available to the CSSM certificates to continue to grow your career through and into the ASIS certification programs. So once you've successfully completed your CSSM, you're eligible to apply for the ASIS APP certification. Similarly, if you start with the APP, you're eligible to apply for the CSSM. No matter what your personal goal is to become a PSP, a PCI, or a CPP, successfully completing the APP will reduce your experience requirements for each of those other certifications by a year. So becoming APP certified is a win for you now for your career progression and a win for you later so you can achieve your further goals more efficiently. Okay, we are super excited to get folks started and moving through your certification journey and moving your careers forward. As a incentive for that, ASIS and IFPO are offering you some discounts for joining today's call. And we hope they encourage you to pursue your career goals. So there are many benefits to becoming a member of ASIS. We've heard a little bit already about networking and access to community. Our online community of security professionals have a wealth of knowledge and support, and they are happy to share them with folks. Many people think that the networking opportunities are the biggest member benefit of ASIS, honestly. I love that part of ASIS, but for new members who are interested in certification, maybe many of you on today's call, the member discounts are amazing. To make sure that you take advantage of your membership benefits as soon as possible, we are offering today a discount code to encourage you to become a member. So when you add a new regular ASIS membership to your cart and use the discount code on the screen within the next week, this is a time-bounded opportunity, you will save $70 off of your membership and application fee. So this is a great discount. That's a $70 value. But you want to do that before you start applying for any certifications with ASIS, because the impact of the discount that you will receive off of your certification exams and any other exam prep materials is wildly amazing. So take a look at that. Beyond that, those discounts that come with just being a member of ASIS, we also want to offer you, if you apply for the APP at that discounted rate as a member, if you do that within the next 30 days after this webinar, we will send you access to our APP online review course, and that will be free to you. If you were to go to our store right now and put this in your cart, it's a $350 item. So again, we want to support you through your journey and we want to get you moving. So here, this is your incentive. Between the two, you're going to save $420 for attending today and getting your process started. All right. And then on the other side, because as we said, ASIS and IFPO are in this together to help you improve and expand your career opportunities. IFPO has offered that if you are CSSM certified, they will waive your current recertification requirements for a one-year cycle if you achieve your APP within that. So it will qualify as your recertification requirement. So again, it's a win on both sides of the table. If you are certified by one organization and go to the other, you're going to see the benefits immediately from joining today's call and seeing how that can turn into great opportunities for you. Additionally, both organizations do offer group discounts. So if your company has multiple team members who would like to sign up and get moving through a certification process, contact us. Both organizations do have ways to get discounts for the larger group contracts so that your organization can save money. It's great to get the discounts if you're paying for it out of pocket. As Matthew said, it is an investment, but it's great for everybody to save a little bit and then get a lot of people moving through and having great, well-trained folks on your teams. And finally, there's more. In addition to what ASIS and IFPO have offered, the ASIS Riyadh chapter is offering 5 scholarships to their Safe Training Academy board certification programs. The scholarships that they are offering will cover 100% of the training tuition. So it's not what you would pay to ASIS, but it is for their training program that they offer. We're going to put a link, actually it's already in the chat, to their website. So feel free to reach out to them and understand how you can apply and qualify for those certifications. But we thought it was great that they're offering 5 100% covered training opportunities. That was a lot. It's a lot to get you started, but aren't you glad you joined today's call and waited all the way to the end? And we're almost there. All right, I'm going to hand it over to Janine. Have we had many questions pop into the chat and the Q&A?
Oops, sorry, I was muted. So thank you, panel, for our presentation. You can enter your questions if you have into the Q&A. We have a few questions. I'm going to start with the first one. Let me find it really quick here. It was one that Nadim wants to answer. So let me just find it really quickly. Sorry, I'm trying to find it really quick.
I'm on it at the moment.
Oh, okay. Sure. Okay. I think it was, will the IFPO give a certification and practically train if the course has been added to ASIS? Is that the one that you asked about?
No, I could take that, but I would leave that for Gary. What I really liked was from Alil Nomes, and he's asking, what about our future professional certifications? IFPO and ASIS will develop and add new certifications. So my point blank answer to that is yes, of course, new programs will come as the life gets more challenging. But allow me to say, certifications provide us focused knowledge on a specific domain, such as we talked about PSP and PCI. But there is a world beyond certifications. What we learn by executing, implementing projects, working with the peer group, there's no other alternative to that. However, I must also say, as I said in the beginning, while doing my part of the professional development, comes a stage where your job is not all that technical, and now you are speaking to multidisciplinary stakeholders. You talk to the finance people, you talk to the supply chain, you influence the HR practices, you persuade the bonus schemes, the long-term retention plans. So once you have got the certifications, which bring you as a shining star, Ali, as you are, knowing you personally, I would say that please do look now horizontally. Could you catch on project management specializations, project risk management? Could you go on strategy execution programs? Business continuity by itself is a very, very broad domain where you get involved in analysis of services, products, procedures. So I do hear what you say and appreciate your interest to move on with further programs from ASIS and IFPO, but I strongly encourage yourself and others to do look at the horizon once your job starts getting more complicated, because now you need more of a strategic persona and communication and stuff like that to get the message across and accepted from the C-levels and the board, so on and so forth. I'm wondering, Ali, if that has answered your question. If no, I'm happy to sort of take on one-on-one basis after this call.
For sure, you are answering very clear. Thank you, and thank you to everyone. And it's a great pleasure to be here with you today with the professional teams. I have one more question. Is there any design for the professional certificate dependent of the region? What I mean is there is a difference between Middle East and Europe and UK, and there is some techniques and rules we cannot to make it here in my country. I will explain more as from my experience when I studied the BCI, there is some techniques it's not allowed to with my government agency, we cannot to do with these techniques. Is there any plan from the IFPO as a higher organization and ASIS to design any certificate depending the region? Where I mean, in line with the government instruction, with the culture of the people. That would be more benefit for everyone. Thank you.
Erika, because I am where Ali is. Could I go on answering this bit also?
Sure.
Sorry if I'm sort of taking on everything. So, Ali, you made a good point, but then it really is a question that would ASIS or IFPO develop a program specific to each country and region? Perhaps not, and the regulators have got their say on doing things the way they are done in each country. So look at it this way. There are global certifications, qualifications. It then trickles down to the standards, which are also global, either from NC or ISO, etc. And then comes the guidelines, which are high-level directions, what best practices to do. But then when it comes down to a country or an organization specific, that call is really to the local chapter to a certain extent to help, or the peer professionals. And that's where the ASIS and IFPO really help us to link to each other, get connected, ask for help. Hey, how do you do it in Dubai? And how do you do it in Qatar? So that's my take on it, but happy to take a reply to you on LinkedIn or the email or a phone call, whatever is comfortable. Thank you.
And I would add from the ASIS perspective, as far as new certifications, the Professional Certification Board is continually evaluating our certification program to ensure that we stay relevant and are moving forward with the profession. Should they discover that there is a need that hasn't been met that is within the ASIS scope and strategic planning and whatnot, we would evaluate that. Again, there, you know, we look at it from both the needs of the profession and the business needs of what can we do to support you, but also, you know, how will we put it out? Because certifications can be kind of expensive to develop. So we want to make sure that there's a solid market and market need out there that we're responding to before we add another certification to the portfolio. And as far as the regional question, I agree with what Nadeem said. You know, every country around the world has nuances and different government and local requirements. What we try to do with the exam development process is have volunteers who are helping us write the items that are from around the globe and can provide feedback to other item writers that maybe this question is too U.S. specific or too Saudi Arabia specific, or, you know, and so the folks who are volunteering for us try to help balance that global impact, and we try to make it as broad as possible where we can. And having global volunteers inform our exam process is key to that. And sometimes I've been on a call where somebody says, well, that isn't applicable to my country. But, you know, three or four other people say, but it is over here. So it's trying to strike the balance between not being one country specific, but broad around the globe as best as we can.
Great. Okay, I'm going to take another question, and this one is for Gary. How does ASIS implement the use of armed and establishment of PMC to carry arms to be able to provide PP to client? You said you wanted to take that one, I think.
Okay, so basically providing firearm support or armed support to people, because, you know, licensing is state to state and country to country, ASIS and IFPO don't get involved in those kind of regulations. They only stick to the theory behind it. So they don't implement the use of armed and establishment of private military contractors to carry arms at any stage. That is the answer.
Great. So I have this one's from another attendee. It says, if we are already ASIS members but not certified, is there any discounted routes for current members? And I can actually take that one if you
go
want.
For it. Sure.
Okay. So current ASIS members get the member rate, which is a significant savings over the non-member rate. So there, that is kind of your discount as far as, but there aren't any other discounts. If you are a member and you are in an emerging market country, you will get the emerging market one or two pricing. The US and Canada does not apply to us and a lot of other countries, but there are a list of countries that are emerging market one and two, and they do get different rates for application and certification exam fees and also membership fees. And people that are members get member rate on the study materials. His other question is also, does either entity offer any credit for being veterans or first responders? So for the initial certification for ASIS certifications, there isn't a discount for veterans, although the VA does reimburse. They have a form and we have it on our website. I can try to find that and put it in the Q&A. But there's a form for that they can send to the VA, and the VA will reimburse for certification applications and I believe study materials as well. Okay, I wanted to get to another question. Unless somebody else on from the IFPO side, Gary or Nadeem, do you have any information about veterans or first responders that IFPO offers?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay, great. I wanted to take another question. This one, it says, I've been a CSSM for many years. Is the APP the right ASIS certification for me? I don't know who wants to take that question.
Yeah, I'll take that. Yeah, so if you've been a CSSM for many years and you fit the criteria, I would urge you to take the CPP exam. We have used it in Ireland, particularly as a pathway. So I've had students who have done the CPO exam, they've done the CSSM exam, and then gone straight on to do the CPP exam, and it does work. And we have proof of concept there. And just so you do know, IFPO does offer a 15% discount for veterans.
Oh, great. Offer. That's great. That's fantastic. And in relation to that question, I just added the self-assessment guide for ASIS certifications. So if you're not sure which certification you may want to go for, and you're not sure if the APP is right for you, the self-assessment guide outlines all four of ASIS certifications in their domains, tasks, and knowledge statements, and puts them in a rate your understanding of each. So it does two things. It can help you decide which certification is right for you, and it also can help you create a study plan when you have decided and you start studying. So I added that link to the chat box. So the next question I wanted to ask is, I am certified by IFPO, but not the CSSM. Do I also qualify for ASIS certifications?
Quite possibly. I would say you'll need to look at the eligibility requirement for the certification that you're interested in and compare your work experience and education background over to the requirements of the certification you're interested in. It's highly likely that you would qualify for the APP. It might depend on that experience and education background, whether or not yet you might qualify for the PSP or the PCI or CPP. I would say take a look at all of the resources that Janine has put into the chat, particularly the certification handbook, to compare your background over to the requirements for each. But there's a good chance that at least the APP will be an opportunity for you.
Okay. Next question, what level of proficiency of the English language is needed to be successful?
So I can take that from the ASIS perspective. All of our certification exams, as I mentioned, are offered in both English and Spanish, and you can choose the language that you're most proficient in or most comfortable in. If you sign up for a Spanish language exam, know that when you are taking your exam, you will be able to also see the items in English. So if needed, you can kind of go back and forth between languages to help you understand the intent of the question. In general, I would have you think about your level of reading comprehension. You need to be able to move efficiently through each question of the exam. As far as like what level of proficiency, it really gets to how quickly you can read your questions. Each exam is set up for about a 1 minute per question. So it's, you know, you do need to be able to move through fairly quickly to read and answer each question. Obviously, some questions might be a little easier for you. So do those, skip and flag. You're able to use a tool within the test driver to flag the questions you want to come back to. So a good testing process would be to, you know, go through and answer the ones that are easier or that you more understand fast, and then go back through and take your time to go through the ones that are a little bit more difficult. But it's hard to say exactly what that level of proficiency required is. But I would say as you are studying, think about how quickly you are able to read and respond to your sample questions. It might help you feel out your comfortable, how comfortable you are with the content. Nadim, it looks like you want to add to that.
Thank you. I'm kind of pushed to take this being a non-native English speaker. So allow me to say, no matter how good my English could be, it is really very difficult that I read some pages and I grasp everything of it on the first go. So essentially, once you read a document and you take your own notes, as you said earlier, and then you start going back to it in your revisions, there's a lot more clarity which will come over a period of time. And that, it doesn't finish there. We've got the mentors from both IFPO and ASIS who are always willing to help. And these study chapters really play a vital role. And further to that are the virtual instructor-led programs offered by IFPO. So no matter where you are, what when you're studying, there will be some difficulties that you will face. And for that, the best option is to either go to a study chapter or take on a virtual training program where you can ask those questions and seek more clarity. I hope that helps to some extent.
Great. Matthew, did you have anything that you wanted to add? I saw that you said something, but I wasn't sure which question you were talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, actually, yeah.
Sorry about that.
No, it's okay. I just, for the interest of time, I just want, it started as a question I wanted to pose to the audience, but this is more of a question that turned into a statement. If anybody works in a frontline security capacity, obviously, and you're, let's say you are more or less don't like the way that let's say your team or yourself are perceived by a client or the public, the best way to really change that is to get certified and to show that you are want to move up, that it's more than just a body and a, or a pulse at a post. By going through these successions and showing that you have a vested interest in protection through these certifications through IFPO and ASIS, you know, we could change it a little, you know, not one person, but little by little, we could all together kind of move the industry forward. And I just looked it up too. A cup of coffee costs, if you drink coffee, average $5 each. If you could put some of that away, you know, it adds up. So think about what's worth it. Investing in your future by sitting for one of these certifications or a second cup of coffee. You know, just pragmatically speaking, you know, patience, and you have to seriously start to invest in your future. I'm just saying this because this is what helped me move forward. So that was my spiel. So thank you.
Great. Thank you, Matthew. So I have another couple questions, and this is kind of a three-parter because it's the same person asking the questions. It says, will the IFPO give us certification and practical training if the course is being added to ASIS? That's the first part. How do we practically learn these online certifications and implement it? And then how do we get a job after attaining the certification?
Actually, Janine, if I may. So I'm assuming a lot of this has to do with the studying. If you are a member, hopefully you will be a member of both of these organizations, you have to leverage in your networking and your chapters. I know for me, when I took my certification, I studied for my CPP, my Western New Jersey chapter, we had a study group. If, you know, even if it's not an official study group, create a study group. Also for the study material that IFPO has for, you know, the CPO and the CSSM, and also, for example, ASIS with the protection of asset manuals, those questions come from that literature. Maybe not verbatim, but that's how you study for it. And I can't stress this enough. If you're expecting to get these certifications overnight, that's just not practical. You have to at least devote easily 6 months minimum to studying. Because, you know, again, it's a serious investment. I'm not trying to dissuade anybody. I'm just, you know, just saying that's, you know, again, Gary, Nadeem, I don't know whether you want to go into your, you know, briefly about your study. That's what's helped for me is just this, you know, with the studying, with my chapter, as well as leveraging my mentorship with these organizations.
Okay. Does anybody want to say a couple last things really quick, and then we're going to wrap up?
Before we wrap, I'm going to put back up on the screen the offer code for the membership and application discount. And just a reminder that is available for the next week. And then please, you know, if you're interested and want to get moving, get your APP application submitted within the next 30 days, and we'll get you connected with that free APP online review course. So I wanted to make sure that those incentives were on your screen before we close up.
Great. And if there's any questions that we didn't get to, we will answer them after the presentation. I should be able to I think we can download those questions. Can we not, Erica? I thought we
could.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Oh, great. So I'd like to thank our panelists for joining us today and sharing their expertise and their insights to our attendees. Mm-hmm. We hope that you enjoyed today's presentation. This session was recorded, and all attendees and registrants will be notified when the recording is available. We hope to see you all at a future session. And this concludes today's presentation. Thank you all for joining us.